More and more people are discovering the unconditional love that comes with having a dog in the family. The terms fur babies and furry children are common in everyday language. However, this love and devotion, coupled with positive training techniques, has seen an incredible number of dogs commuting from the home to the office on a daily basis. Dogs have held jobs for centuries, helping humans in a variety of roles, but the tasks achieved by our talented pooches and their dedicated trainers are becoming even more remarkable. Working dogs come from all backgrounds and are found in every corner of the globe, from the hot Australian outback to the snowfields of North America. Every dog has a job, whether it's out on the beat or fetching a ball. Fetching the ball, lazing around a cafe, playtime at home can all be quite the life for a companion dog. But when there's three of you, well, it's triple the fun. Meet the Browns.
Their nature, their intelligence, and I think the general affection they give you. A very, very affectionate dog. Really loving, and they'll do anything for you, it seems to me. Maybe that's the same with a lot of other dogs, but Border Collies somehow are, they do it with a little more intelligence. You know.
Poppy and her two puppies, Anna and Charlie, have landed on their paws in this family household. But it's Greg who keeps them in check, or rather entertained during the day. And whilst a mother dog can be known to encourage her pups to be independent, Poppy sometimes has her paws full, as these sisters aren't without their sibling rivalry.
The pecking order is that mother is certainly the boss. She has a liking towards Charlie more than Enna, because I think she sees Enna as a bit of a threat, because Enna's the most intelligent of them. And so she nips at her from time to time just to keep her in line. And Charlie's kind of laid back and just sort of lets it all happen. But Enna and Charlie, that is the two puppies, at times get a bit antsy towards each other, I can tell you. They also play fight, you know, and they have fun together. And then when it comes time to go down the park, or if you mention the word B-E-A-C-H, they know and they get really excited. And so they just leap into the car in an order. Actually, that's another thing. Mother gets into the car first, always. Not always, but usually. Then Enna gets into the car, and then Charlie comes on last and climbs into the middle. And off we go.
Greg's car has become a mobile kennel, and these girls feel right at home lounging in a little luxury, being chauffeur-driven to their outdoor boot camp.
Run, chase the ball, get the ball, bring it back. At least two of them do. That is, Enna brings it back, and Charlie likes to chase it, get it, drop it on the ground. Enna goes and picks it up and brings it back. They love jumping for the ball. Well, Charlie does.
The Border Collie is a great dog, incredibly smart, very well trained, very high energy. I certainly know that they are bred to herd or to be a working dog, that I know that sometimes in city environments, they have problems with stress and anxiety if they don't actually work. A lot of owners will take their Border Collies, if they're not in a working situation, will take them to agility or some other type of behavior where they can get that herding mentality out or that working behavior out so that they don't develop the stress and anxiety disorders that some of them will get.
There's very little stress or anxiety for the Browns. Their exercise routine is demanding, but these girls wouldn't have it any other way.
Twice a day, at least, they're taken out for a run. You know, I might walk a couple of Ks around the park, throwing the ball. Apart from that, they come out with me pretty well whenever I can. Well, I just started going up to the coffee shop because it's local. When I arrived with these three, especially when they were little puppies, and everyone started to get to know them, and all the ladies say, aren't they gorgeous? They know the word coffee. Whether they all do or not, I'm not sure, but certainly Enna knows. And I think Poppy knows the meaning of the word.
The word coffee for this trio really seems to mean treat. And whilst coffee might not feature on the menu for these border collies, this is one barista who knows what the girls like most. Being an orthopaedic veterinary surgeon, Raviv Balfour treats a wide variety of dogs with varying disorders. And in this game, the border collie rates well.
Border collies are very good in terms of their orthopedic conditions. They don't tend to get many elbow, they don't tend to get many hip problems. Every once in a while, I will see a border collie with a torn cruciate ligament in the knee. That will show up as a limp when they start working, herding, or in agility. So I think they're infinitely trainable to do whatever task you want them to do. And I think that they tend to be very gentle dogs. And so I think they're great for family situations, given a situation where they can get enough activity that they don't have any stress.
Every child should grow up with a dog as part of the family. I've always thought that. Our kids have. They're always aware of a dog around them. And they learn to look after the dog and love it, you know? And I think it's important. I think children learn to respect animals, not just dogs, from all animals. That's important.
Loving a dog is without doubt incredibly rewarding. What they give back is second to none.
That's part of their job, if you like. They give unconditional love and affection to everyone. Everyone. And you'll be sitting watching TV and all of a sudden one of them will just come up and want a pat or give you a bit of a lick. What more can I say? I mean, it's great to have them around. They just give you the company, but it's just great to have them with me.
The SPCA Auckland wanted to prove how smart rescued dogs were, so they called on Mark Vett, an animal behaviour consultant, to show how capable they are of being trained to do something amazing. So, he taught them to drive a car.
Driving dogs was a crazy concept. It was the hardest training job I'd had to that date. Not for the faint-hearted, I can tell you.
Standing at an impressive 2 feet tall at the shoulder, Monty is a giant schnauzer cross, and you'll always see him happily bounding around the house with a ball.
We chose him like we choose a film dog. He's got to be confident, he's got to be sociable, he's got to be food and ideally play driven, which he was. He's the clown of the show, but actually is really smart as well.
Always up for a challenge, Mark built a specially designed driving rig. Once he's mastered this, he'll be driving a real car. Monty is one of the world's first driving dogs.
So this rig was probably one of the primary tools to really get the dog thinking and running sequences of behaviour together as if he's in the car.
Taking Monty for a drive, Mark uses a clicker and snacks to reward him for applying the right behaviour on cue. Monty concentrates on the directions he's been given by Mark as they take the rig for a spin.
This is Monty's driving rig. So we've got a rig that's set up the same as inside the Mini that we're training in. This is the accelerator here. And so that's his general driving position. And if I ask him to turn, so turn, 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 turn. Good boy, that's his turning behaviour. That allows him to get around the corners, starting the car. Good boy. As we move across to the other side of the car, we've got the brake, B, that's his brake. And his gear shift, gear, gear, gear. It's an automatic, so he shifts it into gear.
Monty doesn't become a road hog when he gets behind the wheel and drives courteously at all times. Monty takes the corners like a pro. No pit stops here. And he stays within the speed limit, which is a good thing, because he doesn't want to draw any attention from the local constabulary.
No speeding tickets. He can tell the cops off of any problem, you know. When we were rehearsing down here, we got permission to go down to the neighbours, the big car park over the road. We were sitting on the side and a cop pulls up. We hadn't got on the road, luckily. He says, "What's going on here, guys?" He says, "Oh, we're shooting a scene, and this is the driving dog, you know." And he looks at the dog and he says, "That dog's not going on the road, is he?" "Oh, of course not, sir. Of course not. Of course not."
It took 8 to 10 weeks to get Monty up to speed, and then it was time to put Monty into a real car on a controlled racetrack to see how the training has paid off. After 40 years training dogs, Mark has developed a special working relationship with his canine companions.
When I wake up in the morning, as soon as I do anything, you'll hear this tail just hitting the wall, you know. And he knows I'm up, he knows what's happening, and he starts his greeting routine. So Monty's classic thing that normally as an animal behaviourist you would teach out of a dog is he grabs a gift, and doesn't matter what it is, it'll be the shoe or the television control or whatever it is, and he's got to have something in his mouth. He's got that real retrieve in him. He's just got this beautiful temperament where he just loves to be with you.
Adopting a dog from a shelter is a wonderful way to fall in love with your next Fido, Bruce or Layla. But whilst these new pets are waiting to head off to their forever home, they have a job helping those who help them.
Yeah, well, while you're in prison, you tend to overthink things, really, and you intensify it, and you don't even mean to, but when you're out here, all your problems and that pretty much just go out the window. And you're just here with the dogs, taking them for a walk.
Well, I never got to grow up around dogs, so it's a chance for me to interact with them and, yeah, get to know them a bit better.
Zach and Rory are both serving time at the Wandoo Reintegration Facility, a minimum security prison that's designed to prepare young men from the age of 18 to 28 for transition back into the community. And what could be better than the opportunity to have a dog by your side for this journey?
I've been coming for 9, 10 months so far, and it's good just to get out of the prison and play with some dogs. I've always liked dogs growing up, so getting to play with them is just therapeutic. Big one would just be the companionship, like just always someone at home, someone to play with, never get lonely with a dog.
Michael and the other inmates embrace this opportunity to work in the community. Whilst for the team at the Shenton Park Dog Refuge, the help from the Wandoo guys is invaluable.
The young men from Wandoo facility come in 3 times a week. They help us with a whole raft of activities. But I guess one of the biggest things is they actually interact with their dogs. So all of our dogs on the facility get walks at least once a day. And it's really important for the animals' welfare that they get out of the kennel, they have that really important human interaction and socialisation. And that's where the young men really help us. Our volunteers are critical to us. And without our volunteers, we wouldn't be able to do that.
Whilst enabling the dogs to improve their socialisation skills, the young men are also developing skills of their own.
But at the end of the day, everybody's here because they love dogs. So the young men, they actually get to socialise a lot with a lot of our volunteers and our staff. So it's really that step in helping them transition back into society. Obviously, having the responsibility of walking the dogs, that provides them with self-confidence, improves their self-esteem and their respect for themselves. And that also teaches them, you know, that they can be a real positive influence to the community and the society. And of course, unconditional love from dogs. You know, these young men are actually learning how to form relationships and really bond with our dogs.
The men wear a GPS tracking device around their ankles, which allows them the freedom to move about the shelter without being attached to a guard at all times. Plus, it gives them a chance to really connect with the dogs in their own way.
I've noticed when coming here, like when I'm out with the dogs, that if I'm dealing with any problems or anything like that. Like, they disappear while I'm out here with them. It's kind of undescribable, really. It's, I don't know, it's someone else's companion, but you share a bond with that dog also, you know?
A lot of these guys have grown up, they might not have had any self-worth. They might have grown up in a really difficult situation where they didn't feel like they could really do anything. And something as simple as having results with a dog and spending time with a dog, they sort of change their view about themselves, which is amazing. One of the things that really struck me was one of the lads, you know, he said to one of the dogs who's locked in the kennel, he said, "Oh, I know how you feel, buddy," you know. So they can really relate. I mean, a lot of people can relate to dogs, but they can really relate to these guys because they're locked up as well.
Wandoo's focus is on providing life and employment skills in the critical period, from custody back to the community. One-on-one support is provided, as is an emphasis on care and well-being, all with the aim to reduce re-offending. Much like the dogs, these young men are looking for a fresh start.
One of the other reasons why we come out and do this is so that when they do get released from prison, it's not a great shock. Like, they've been out in the community, they've been talking to other people, they've been doing things rather than just being locked up and then one day they're free. Coming up to their release time, a lot of them do get quite nervous because they're really not sure how they're going to go. It really helps them to normalise them, I guess, and so they know it's not going to be such a shock when they come out. And also that level of responsibility and achievement too, especially if they're walking a dog. No, they feel like they've done something and achieved something.
All volunteers at the dog refuge go through varying levels of training, starting with the yellow badge for the easier to walk dogs, moving to green, and then graduating to blue for the more experienced handlers. But no matter what level you're at, once you make the commitment to look after these dogs, it seems you're hooked.
We've seen young men from Wandoo come back. They want to come back as volunteers. They've also come back to adopt dogs. This place has been a real positive influence for a lot of them in many different ways. Dogs can really sense when individuals need that love and additional support. You really see the bonds that form between some of our volunteers and their dogs. And I think that's from that dual need on both sides. You know, the dogs are looking for love and respect, and so are the people.
I get out in 8 months. I've done 22 months so far, so on the home stretch now. I do want to own my own dog, and having come here for so long, I probably will adopt a dog instead of buying one.
I'd like to think I will follow it when I get out, come here and help them out, because I do like this place and the staff here. They're really nice and I've gained a lot out of it. It reminds me of my dog at home. And I don't know, I just really enjoy it.
Drugs in the workplace is a serious issue and one organisations don't take lightly. So New Zealand detector dogs train their dogs to sniff out a range of narcotics.
We take dogs from rescue centres, from animal welfare organisations, and then we train them as drug dogs and we screen work sites for work site safety reasons.
A lot of the dogs used in their teams come from unloved backgrounds or shelters. The approach to transition these dogs to top dogs is to use positive reinforcement, taking the negative out of their lives. Often that includes rewarding them with toys and food, which works a treat.
When we first get a dog, we'll play a game that we call scent association. So we'll get various items and we'll put drugs inside them. And we encourage the dog to come up to our hand, and when it does, it comes up to the hand that's holding the cannabis, we reinforce it with food.
Kai is an intelligent black Labrador that his family could no longer look after. And he was going to have to be put down if a new owner couldn't be found. Luckily, Janet took Kai in to train him up as a drug detector dog. Training begins with Kai being taken around the training centre, where drug samples have been planted for him to find. The handler lets the dog move around the area. When Kai finds a scent of interest, he'll let the handler know by scratching at the affected area. He's then rewarded with food.
When they first encounter scent, they show what's called a change of behaviour. So that might be the very first sign that the dog's detected something. His love and life is just getting out there using his nose. When we started training Kai, within 2 days he'd picked up the game and he's never looked back. Normally a worksite will call us in for one of two reasons. One, they're a worksite that want to be proactive and ensure that they don't have drug hazards on their site and that all their staff are safe to be at work. The other reason may be that they have detected drugs in their worksite and then they want to make sure that there's no further drugs in there. We teach the dogs to find drug odour and we teach them to find it in various quantities. So we're talking from massive quantities to the minute particles. Hey Ross, so this is Sarah. She's going to do sweep of the warehouse for you. If you could show around, that'd be great. What they're detecting is that the person's either been in close contact with drugs or may have something on them like drugs or paraphernalia or drug utensils. So the dog may indicate the person and they indicate in a passive response, so that means they'll sit. It's pretty nondescript. It's not designed to alarm anyone. It's quite discreet. It's not about legal or illegal, it's purely about safety and whether that guy's going to go home at the end of the shift and whether his mates around him are safe to be at work as well.
Drug detecting dogs are used to screen a range of sites, including offices, apartments, schools, warehouses, work sites, vehicles, or even vessels. These canine cops won't turn their nose up at any job.
Hey Ross, that's us all done. A clean sweep for the day and we'll see you next time.
Cool.
All right, see ya. One of the things I guess that all our handlers take pride in is that we get these rescue dogs. But with these dogs, what they have to overcome to achieve that is enormous. And I think for me, after 20 years as a dog handler, I've never had more pride in seeing these young dogs that have just been badly treated overcome that and just work for us and do a fantastic job.
Jobs that suit a specific breed of dog, and then there are those jobs where anything goes.
He's a funny looking dog with a great nature. What's not to like about him? Look at him. He's a genuine mixed breed. He's just lovely. That's all there is to it. Not a mean streak in his body.
This is a case of love at first sight. Manu needed a new home, and John, unexpectedly, found himself with a new chief of staff.
I just work for him, basically. I take him for an all-day walk and he just hangs around while I do all the work and then just points me in the way home at the end of the day. Head lawnmower guy, security, owner and operator, I suppose you could say. I just look after him.
Manu takes his supervisory role very seriously. There's a lot of strategizing required for this job, particularly when it comes to turning on the charm.
You turn up to mow a lawn and he knows the ones that always look after him because he jumps out of the ute and straight up to the door and he'll just sit there waiting for them to come out. One lady said, oh, last time he was here I gave him a whole chicken, and there was another client, just he come out one day and giving him all this roast lamb. I said, oh, there you go, man, a bit of leftover roast lamb. She went, oh, yeah, we cooked it last night. I just thought Manu would like it, and I'm just going, well, give it to me. I'd eat that.
While Manu's loyalty may stray a little when there's a tasty treat on offer, he's always got an eye out for his number one employee.
He's about as soft as they come, really. He always got to be around you. If he's sitting there beside you, he's got to be like leaning up against you. Or he goes to sleep when you're driving along and he's got to put his head on your lap. Loyal. That's about it. He'd follow you anywhere and he'd always be there for you. Like, he knows that I've never let anything happen to him, and he'd never let anything happen to me, I don't think. Which is good. Which is why it should be.
So, with this workplace arrangement, it begs the question, who really is in charge?
He likes to think he's the boss, but at the end of the day, I get paid. he doesn't. I'm pretty sure he's upset about it, and once he gets his union together, he'll probably have something to say about it.
If ever there was a way to spread happiness, it's a visit from our friendly furry friends. Every Wednesday, the Kingsgate Resource Centre in London is a buzz with wagging tails and glowing smiles, brightening everyone's day.
It's just seeing their faces light up. You walk into a room and as soon as they see the dog, their eyes light up.
Initiated by the Mayhew Animal Home, these volunteers and their dogs specialise in visits to people with dementia and to palliative care centres.
Therapaws is the Mayhew's animal therapy programme. It's a programme where volunteers take their dogs that we assess out to places to interact with older people to provide a therapeutic service. We go to care homes, nursing homes, hospitals, hospices, community centres, anywhere where there's a group of older people who might need some sort of animal therapy. Specifically, today is when stroke survivors come in. So these are people who have survived mini or major strokes and come in for a range of activities to help them rehabilitate themselves. And it gives people a chance to stroke the dog, which helps with their arm movements, and they're sort of exercising or stretching without realizing they're doing it because they're enjoying it so much.
Today's visit is from Charlie, Deborah and Caroline with their dogs Lola, Noodle and Biscuit, each of whom were rescued via the Mayhew Centre and have enormous love to give.
My dog's called Lola. She's a Staffordshire Bull Terrier. She's the most friendly, relaxed, chilled out dog ever. She's amazing with the old people on the Therapaws programme.
Noodle's a schnoodle, which is a ridiculous name for a mutt. She's a rescue dog. The second she puts the little jacket on, she knows she's working, and she adores being petted.
Well, the nicest thing, I think, is that when I come in with Biscuit, you see people's eyes light up. We often talk about their memories about pets they used to have and dogs they used to walk and how important animals are in their life. And it's nice unlocking those memories. Just seeing them laugh and enjoy the company of the dog is really rewarding for me.
You have a relationship with a dog that you can see quite often, you know. It's not your own, but it's a good relationship, and they recognise you, which is nice too.
What's great about having the dogs here is that with speech, if they're having problems communicating with other humans, they don't need that to interact with the dog, so it can be a real sense of relief and getting their frustration out. With the muscle movements, it's fantastic because they can use their arms to stretch out and stroke the dog and groom the dog, give the dog a treat, and they're actually exercising their muscles without really realising. It's really therapeutic on a number of different levels.
None more so than Jim, whose regular visits from Biscuit are not only a weekly highlight, but have inspired some extra treats for everyone involved.
He takes some treats in his hand, raises his hand up, and she lifts her paw and pushes it down so she can eat it. And it just makes everybody laugh and everyone smile.
Oh, it's great, yeah. But that was very accidental, that was, with the dog. One day my hand was kind of bit and I shifted her, and she pulled my hand down. That's how that started. And now I keep my hand up and she pulls it down.
I think for a lot of the people who come here, they're quite lonely. They don't have a lot of interaction with people outside the centre. This is where they come every day and this is their social life. And some of them don't have a lot of people they can talk to or connect with. And just bringing animals in is a bit of light relief.
It's clear that this job for dogs is one of the most rewarding and beneficial to have on your canine CV.
It's like a privilege to be able to come in and meet elderly people who sometimes they're very lonely and we can get to know them really well. I've made friends through doing this and I look forward to my visits to see them as much as they look forward to the visits to meet the dog and us.
I think the most rewarding thing is there are some people who are suffering from real depression or isolation, but when the dogs come in, their whole sort of personality and body language changes, and seeing those actual changes in those people's behaviour, which then help their health, is incredible.
Situated on top of a volcano overlooking Auckland is the training centre for conservation dogs New Zealand. And two of the inhabitants have million-dollar views of the city.
Two dogs we've got here today are called Pi and Piri. They are both rodent dogs. Pi belongs to me and Piri belongs to Carol. The two dogs we've got are actually siblings, but they've got different mothers. They've both got the same father. Their father was a dog by the name of Jack. He was a great ambassador for the whole conservation dog program because he was such a character. He ended up having an accident in his later years, and through medical misadventure we had to take off one of his front legs. And so he ended up working for the last 3 years of his working life on three legs, and he did that really well. But that was part of his charisma, I guess.
Jack would be very proud of Pi and Piri and the brilliant job they're doing keeping pests off the island. They have their father's nose.
Their primary role is to protect the threatened species that are out on our pest-free islands where there are no rats or mice. Their job is to find any rats or mice that might be hiding on vessels that might be going to those pest-free islands. But they also, we take the dogs out to those pest-free islands at least twice a year to do a thorough search to make sure that nothing's slipped through our net, so to speak.
The relationship between the handler and their dog is very important, as they'll be working hand in paw for up to 10 years.
We like to have the handlers take the dogs on themselves to build that bond right from when they're really young. We choose terriers because they've got a natural prey drive for small mammals. From quite young, we'll get a dead mouse and just generally play with the puppy and get it all excited about that. Then we'll play hide and seek with the dead mouse. We'll hide it somewhere and get the puppy to find it. And you slowly build on that and you're building the dog's prey drive.
These two enthusiastic terriers have been trained to track down pests, in particular rats, a job they tackle with fervour. What they lack in size, they more than make up for in work ethic.
Piri is quite a laid-back wee girl. She's three quarters border terrier and a quarter fox terrier. And Pi, her half-brother, is almost manically focused on rats and mice, almost to the point where it can be a bit challenging. If you want to go for a walk somewhere, if there's the remotest chance that there might be a rat or a mouse there, he's into it. And so you just need to be aware of that.
It takes around 18 months of daily training to certify a handler and their dog. Once certified, they'll still need to train several times a week for the duration of the dog's working life. It's important that the dogs have excellent socialisation skills, and they often work on wharfs and jetties, where they'll be around large numbers of tourists sniffing out bags for rascally rodents. The dogs need to be comfortable in all types of working scenarios.
A large chunk of the work these dogs do is we call it quarantine. So what we're going to show you today is in one of our tunnels, which is a space we can do it where it's nice and quiet, we've got a whole lot of bags and boxes and bits and pieces there that we'll get the dogs to search. In one of those bags or boxes, I've hidden a pet mouse. The other dog handler here, she keeps a couple of pet mice.
Willis, the pet mouse, is more of a training associate than a pest. Carol brings him out from the office when Pi and Piri need to catch up on some training. But don't worry, Willis is perfectly safe. These tunnels burrowed into the volcano would have been full of soldiers a few years back, but now they're used to train the dogs to locate pests. Carol has placed Willis the mouse somewhere amongst these scattered items.
We will take that pet mouse with us and we might hide it because it's really important that the dogs actually have a find, because 99% of the time when and where they're working, they actually don't find anything. For us, it can be a bit of a drag, but that's actually what it's all about. We don't want to find stuff, but then the dogs are trained to find stuff. So yeah, we artificially give them a find to keep them keen.
It's been said that when you do something you love, it isn't work anymore.
Dogs have been my life, they're my passion. I've landed my ultimate dream job. I'm working with dogs and I'm working with dog handlers, and people who love dogs are always good people.
In the world of doggy fur children, there seems to be a new slant on the traditional rhyme. Something old, something new, something borrowed, something blue, with the addition of something that barks.
When you commit to buying a dog, you know that you're going to have them for 10, hopefully 15 years. So Dex was very, you know, big milestone before we built a house, before we got engaged, before the wedding. Nala just came along, just fortunately, to keep Dex company, and obviously we fell in love with her bubbly, silly personality, and then that's just where it went from there. There was no question. They're always going to be at the wedding. They're our family.
Oh, I suppose it's every little stage we've done in our life as well. They've been part of it, so it's just another stepping stone, another part of our life.
Wedding dogs are strolling up the aisle, posing for photos, and even dressing in style to help their humans celebrate the big day.
Peter and Steve were fantastic, and Dexter and Nala were absolutely gorgeous. So we were really lucky to be involved in their wedding. It was just such a beautiful day, and we were able to bring Nala and Dexter to their wedding, be there at the ceremony. They were ring bearers and walked down the aisle for that occasion. Then we were able to have some fantastic photos and then take them home for them. And it was really important to them to be able to have them at their wedding. So we were just really, really happy that we could make that happen.
Karen and Greg have been in this game for years and have three rescue dogs of their own, all with unique personalities, so they know what it takes for any wedding dog to perform this important role.
They were there early to greet everyone, so they didn't get too excited seeing everyone there at once. So if people come one by one, they got to meet them.
Then throughout the photos, they came and they joined us, and they were great. Karen really took care of them, and everyone knows the dogs as well. So once we were there, everyone was patting dogs and playing with them, and, you know, they were just really just doing their thing. They were better behaved than we thought. They did their job, absolutely, on the day. They knew that they had something very important to do, and they took their role seriously, and, you know, they walked down the aisle, and Nala every now and again snuck off to try and say hello to people as she went. It was awesome for them. They got to see all their favourite people all in one spot, and we're all dressed up, and everyone was giving them attention. They loved every second of it, I think, as much as us. Yeah.
Getting the dogs ready for their moment in the spotlight isn't just a walk in the park, although this is a key element of the preparation.
Get them calm so that they can find a nice tree. There's lots of nice new trees for them to communicate on. It just gets them ready to meet all their guests and their mum and dad and have their photos taken and nice and happy and calm and ready to perform, as they say.
The countdown is on for Leroy's grand entrance. There'll be a few guests to surprise, then the biggest tail wagging moment of the day, when Janelle and Greg come out from the ceremony.
We're going to be making sure that Leroy is at the right place at the right time as they exit the building with their guests, and he'll be there to have special photos with his parents. He's a really cool dude. We're very lucky and very fortunate that most of the dogs that we have at weddings are really relaxed and really happy, and we do come with a lot of bribery and treats to win them over. It's really fulfilling, you know. It's a really feel-good feeling for us that we get to bring their pets, who they love so much, to such an important day in their lifetime. You know, it's a once-in-a-lifetime thing for them. Plus, we get to make lots of new friends.
It just, to me, makes 100% sense just to have them there. They make you feel happy, you know. They make you feel relaxed. It makes you, you know, grounds you to the day, just that it keeps you... You know, they're your dogs. This is what it's about. It's about family and love and everything like that. And we've got all those memories forever, long after they're gone. We've got their recordings, we've got their videos, you know, we've got photos forever. It's life-changing. Do it.
Nestled in the stunning countryside of Auckland is a training school with a difference. This school prepares dogs for the world of show business.
Blue's an awesome dog. He's got such a beautiful temperament. He's a beardie, so he's a working hunterway. He's a tricolour, so he's got a great look. And for television, he's got an awesome look because he's got a lot of contrast, but also very intelligent. So that's a big feature for him. Good boy.
Hunterways are a big, strongly built breed of dog that are used for getting sheep into pens, as well as working them in yards and wool sheds. All Huntaways are bred to bark, and they have a loud, deep bark. Their size and shape varies widely. Their coats may be long and shaggy or smooth-haired, and they're usually black and tan.
He was a rescue dog, so when we got him very early on, he was a bit of a mess. He had a number of problems, some serious barking problems. We worked with him in the very early days on a number of commercials, and we found he's got the skills. He's both a beautiful family dog and a superstar.
Getting into acting can be a dog-eat-dog business, but if you've got the raw talent, you'll always get the part. Blue has spent the best part of his life working on movies and television commercials, all without becoming a prima donna.
Blue's forte is his confidence and his stability and his sociability, you know. So when you're on set working with kids or other actors or anything like that, you've got to have a dog that you know is safe and confident, but also really smart. He's probably worked on 10 or 15 movies. He's worked on, you know, something like 50, 60 ads. So he's got quite a CV.
While Blue is coming to the end of his illustrious movie career in front of the cameras, there's still a lot of life left in the old dog.
He's actually just in the last retirement phase of his work life, so he did an old dog job the other day, and so he was 3 days on set, so being absolutely mollycoddled, even though he's still fit as a fiddle. You know, he has his own camper, of course, but he builds a rapport with the actor, and he's got a really good way of bonding with an actor, and, you know, he'll hang with them and walk with them and do stuff and actually look like he belongs to them.
Mark Vett has been doing clinical and behavioural work with dogs for over 40 years, so he knows how to get the best out of them for any job.
On you, Mark. The click happens just as his foot hits the mark. So that's how I teach a dog. That's exactly what I want you to do. So if I throw his food back again and I say, on your mark, you watch. As soon as he puts his foot on his mark, on the mark, click, food reward.
Mark takes Blue through some of the basic techniques he'll need when he gets on set. The specialised training uses a click and reward technique.
So if I want to now tell him to bark on command or speak, so I give him a little hand signal, so I give him a little... And I click and reward him.
Blue is also being trained to react to a face command, which is guaranteed to have audiences wanting more.
Ready? Face. Face. Good. Good boy. We have another little tool here where we teach a touch target, where he learns just to touch any target. Touch. Good.
At the end of the day, there's always time to get together with the other guys for a bit of fun in the back garden.
I would say it's pretty close to the best job in the world. I mean, I spent the last 6 months just writing a book. I thought that was pretty cool. I've got a beautiful environment, a lovely family. Yeah, we love our work, and this is where we work. This is what we do. It's pretty cool.
There's a lot of tail-wagging fun, whether you're chasing the ball, enjoying the sunshine at a local cafe, guarding a lawnmower, or sniffing out the specified scent in drug detection work. Positive-based training and food rewards make for some very happy dogs. And who doesn't deserve a little extra morsel, especially if you're the number one driver on the canine track? When you have the skills to make it up to the top of your game, a victory lap or even an extra spin is totally in order. Add a few wedding pooches and you soon realise that dogs have a vast role to play in so many communities across the world. Working dogs truly are friends for life.